Era, medieval age. This is your review for two. Good day, my name is Joe Gerba. Today I'll be going over Era, medieval age and how it plays with two players. Now, Era is a 1-4 player game where you'll be trying to rebuild your city. It'll just be you, a farm, and a couple longhouses with some peasants in them. And as the game progresses, you'll be building these walls, fending off attacks from everybody else, and kind of building up your little city, your little town, putting churches, building townhouses, markets, more farms, and hopefully by the end of the game, you have the most points, and which is comprised of the buildings you have, a couple extra end of game bonuses, your knowledge, and then you subtract the disaster points you've occurred throughout the game, and whoever has the most points wins the game. Now see a little bit more how to play. So in this game, each player is going to start with two scorched areas, one farm, their keep, and a couple longhouses. So the longhouses and the keep kind of give you the rolling start that you're going to have. And I say that because you'll be rolling these dice. For every longhouse you roll or you have, you get to roll a yellow dice. And for every keep, you get to roll a gray dice. And you're going to roll these and gather various materials. It may be stone. It may be wood. It may be grain to feed your people, and you'll be rolling those dice, and you can roll each dice up to three times. Now, if you get a skull, you have to stop, and we'll go over that in a second. Then you'll be gathering the materials, so you'll get to gather all the die face shown, and you'll have to feed your people, and that's where it becomes interesting, where each die you roll is a person in your kingdom. So you have to subtract that many food from your supply. And if you don't have that many, the disaster strikes and you have to move in the disaster. You have to move down on your disaster track. And remember, that's negative points at the end of the game. Then you go into your actual kind of disaster phase and you count the number of skulls, and certain things may happen depending on how many skulls you have. There are a couple good numbers where you can give stuff to your neighbors and kind of scorch their area a little bit, but be careful because the skulls usually kind of lock your dice as you're really trying to roll. And then you'll go into the build phase for each hammer you have, which is one of the other die faces. You'll get to build. You can build some walls, build some more farms, build another longhouse. And so once you do that, you'll add that die to your pool. And now you get to roll an extra die. So instead of having the three and one for the keep, you now have four die from your longhouses and one for your keep. But remember, it's a neat check and balance where the more dice you roll, the more you have to feed them, and your maximum food you can have is 10. So you can have over 10 dice, but you'll be accruing those disaster points. But you'll use your resources to build certain buildings, and it's a really neat kind of roll and build game. At the end of the round, you'll go into kind of the combat, the extort phase. Whoever has the most swords on their gray dice can take a good from everyone who has less. And usually, on the two-player game, it's usually not the biggest deal, but stealing a resource can be pretty valuable for the next turn. And you'll keep going and building these buildings, walling up your walls. You get double points for having buildings inside fully walled areas. There's a lot of end of game bonuses. And once one of the piles of buildings depletes, you'll be flipping over one of these tokens to the X side, and there's only a finite amount of buildings. And once that happens three times, that triggers the end of the game. You'll finish out the round and count your points on the score pad, and whoever has the most will win the game. So see a little bit more what I thought. So let's talk about the components in this game. This game is very hands-on. You're always doing something, and I love that in a game. I like that everybody can roll their dice, and not the non-locked dice you can roll a couple more times, decide what you want to build. Everything's right there. It's a really fun game. I really like these pieces. You get a really nice 3D kind of view of each person's city, or town or little kingdom. By the end of the game, everybody's going to look a little bit different. There's a lot of different strategies with kind of a finite amount of buildings. It's a really good time, and the components add a lot to this game. The rules in this game were very simple. I really enjoyed it. It was straight to the point. The rule book had examples. Probably took me about 10 minutes to read. Not very long at all. Everything was clear, concise. There's references everywhere, whether it's inside your screen when you're rolling behind the screen. There's a reference on the back of the rule book. There's just so many helpful tips here and there that just the icons in this game are very well presented. This doesn't take up a whole lot of table space for two. A 3x3 would be perfect. And I just think being that close, being that kind of intimate, you know, watching the other person, I just think the rules, the presentation of this game is off the charts. Now, I will have to knock it a little bit. Just because the original board kind of came with indentions for all the numbers. Now, mine did come with stickers. Not everybody's will come with stickers. I put mine on, and the game works great. I can see all the numbers fine. But just make sure that your copy, when you do get it, does come with those stickers, because these numbers can be tough to read. But mine came with stickers. They went on really well. Everything's clear, concise. I just thought, like I said, the references were just great for this game. So is this game fun? And my answer is yes, because you're always doing something. You always have a lot of choices, except if you don't roll any build icons, you know, on your dice. But, you know, it's pretty rare. You get a couple re-rolls. Two of the basic die sides have the build icons. So you should, you know, really try to be able to do something every turn, but you'll always be rolling dice. You'll actually... In this game, some of these games are kind of solitaire. In this game, you will be caring about what the other person is doing. Are they building a couple extra keeps? Are they going to try to steal one of my resources every turn? What kind of strategy are they going for? Are they going to take the last building and try to end that game? So in the two-player game, there's a couple buildings that only have one building. Are they working towards that building? So you do have to care what the other person is doing. So in some of these games, it comes a little bit more solitaire. But this game, you can actually see how the other person's board's looking. As they're rolling their dice, it will be secret, and you're rolling your dice in secret too. But in the end, you can easily see. And that's what makes the components so cool, is I can easily see what you're doing, how many dice you're rolling. Everything's color coordinated very well on this board. It's just, it's a fun little game. Resource management. Do I want to save up for this? What am I going to do this game? Do I want a bigger wall? You get more points for having a bigger walled in area at the end. There's a lot of things to think about. Some of your turns may be a little bit shorter because you didn't get quite the roll you wanted to, but you know, that's why we roll the dice. If we knew what was going to happen by the end of the game, you know, we wouldn't roll the dice. And it's a fun, lighthearted game where you're building your little kingdom. And instead of building your kingdom of cards, like in a lot of games, like I love the villagers, but you're building a kind of villagers of cards. But in this game, you have a 3D representation of what you're building. And I just think that's so neat. It's very easy to teach. Go through it a few times. You know, you can always try a different strategy. You can pick up these churches for, you know, to roll the white dice. You can pick up, you know, the townhouses to roll the blue dice, and those give you extra benefits that some of these other dice won't give you, you know. And it's a fun, you know, back and forth. You know, there's a ton of options. I do just really like this game for the lightheartedness. Is this the most strategic game in the world? No. But by the end, it's a little bit of point salad. How many buildings do you have walled? You know, rolling dice, end of game bonuses, your farms, you know, do you build those? They're really cheap, but they give you a constant food per turn. You know, the lumber mill, is it worth the 3 wood to get a constant, you know, 2 per turn? And it's just, there's a lot of choices in this game. It's a lot of fun. With the two players, it goes by very quickly. We play this game in about 45 minutes a piece, you know, and we'll play two games back to back. We may play 3 games in an evening, but we've had a lot of fun with this game. Now, the replayability for this game, I say, is pretty high. You may not get the fullest extent of replayability. There's only a finite set amount of buildings, But at the same time, you know, my wife and I think we've played about 12 games now, and there's always something new to try. Do you want to try a small wall and make sure that you can wall off quickly? Maybe try to end the game before your opponent finishes their wall. Do you want to try to get all the blue buildings, roll a lot of blue dice and see what you can do, see if you can advance on the knowledge track faster than your opponent? There's a lot of little things you can do in this game, but overall, I think this game is fairly replayable. You do have a finite set, so it is going to be kind of the same. You're always going to try to want to upgrade your long houses, upgrade, you know, some of those fairly quickly to get the extra die. But there's always a couple extra little things that you can try here and there that really increases the longevity of this game. Now let's go into luck versus strategy. This game is luck based. Let's be honest. You're rolling dice. You can mitigate that by getting multiple rolls. But in the end, if you don't have a build for the turn and you have a ton of resources, hopefully next turn you roll those hammers and you get to building on the next turn. But there is still some strategy in this game. Do you make the small wall? You can decide at the beginning what you want to go for. You may have to change the, change what you do on the fly compared to what, you know, resources you kind of get. So I do say there is a high bit of luck, but there is a lot of strategy too. You know how big the footprint are on these buildings. You know where they can and can't fit. You know your kind of end goal. The end conditions are available for everyone to see. So I think it has a pretty good balance and gives a chance for everyone to win. So is this game good for two? And I do love this game for two. You know, I really didn't have the highest expectations for this game. It'd be rolling dice and building your stuff. But man, we've had just a good time. Now, will this game last for years and years, you know, after 50 plays for two? Yeah, probably not, but there's not a whole lot of games that do. Like I said, we've played about 12 games now and just had a blast each time. 45 minutes, starting with, you know, hardly anything to building up to a good sized city with a lot of buildings and a lot of choices at the end. It just has been a whole lot of fun, you know, for two. There's a couple mechanics in the game that change quite a bit, mainly in the extort phase, which is the gray dice, kind of the fighting dice. You know, if you have more swords than the opponent, you get to steal a resource. Well, in a multi-person game, you'd get to steal a resource from every person you had more swords than. So it can really boost a lot of the attacks where if you roll three or five skulls, can really hurt your opponents in the, you know, 3 to 4 player game, because you get to dole out, you know, maybe one of these scorched areas to each one of the opponents instead of just one person. So you may be going for that. That may be your strategy in the 3 to 4 player game. But in this one, the attacking is very light, which I do like, but it's still there. You're still having to interact with the other person. Don't think that just because the attacking's kind of light, just think that the, it's a pretty simple system, doesn't mean that it's not important. So we really enjoyed this game for two. My wife really enjoys like the little town building, city building, you know, usually in tableaus or something like this. But it's a physical game. And that's what just makes this game neat, is you almost feel like you're playing with a set of toys and it's a board game. So we've had a great time with it. It's been a lot of fun, you know, rolling dice, easy to learn, easy to get to the table. It's a good, solid all around game that definitely is not going to leave the collection, because I can definitely see this game also being able to be played, you know, with three or four. Easy to teach, easy to get out. You know, especially for someone kind of newer to the hobby, it's a very simple game and can really be a big kind of a boost motivation for, oh, this is more about board games. So I really like this game for two, but I wouldn't count this game out for 3 to 4 either, because I think with those it can be easy to just a good solid game. So for two, this gets my thumbs up, and I recommend Era Medieval Age. So hope you guys had a good time, and until next time.